There is a good God that loves us, and we need to pursue him. Pursue him. We always think that we're there. We're there. We don't need to go any farther. We don't. Yeah, we do need to pray, but that God is closest as he's ever going to get. And that's really not true. You can never get too close to God. And God can never get too close to you. Pursue the one that loves you. That's the heading of this. Pursue the one that loves you. Because without this understanding that you need God, with you need faith in God, it says, without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that comes to God must believe that he is God. He is Almighty. He's the one that governs everything. He's the one that governs everything. He has laws set forth. If you do this, this is what happens. You do that, that's what happens. Isn't that a good thing? What if there was no laws in the spirit realm? What if everything was whatever will happen? That'd be horrible. But that isn't how God works. And yet we wonder sometimes, what about all the little kids? What about all the suffering in the world? And I would say, what about it? What about it? What about all the suffering? What about the innocent? I'll tell you this, that if this whole earth worshiped God and the one true God, Jesus Christ, there would be peace on earth and goodwill to all men. Amen? It would be Christ-like here on earth, and God would dominate this whole globe. But he says, you go this way, you follow a different God, you'll have chaos. How many know that there's chaos in the Muslim world? Amen? And that the Muslim world is bringing chaos into all the world. ISIS is Muslim. Amen? Right from the Quran, it says what they need to do. They are zealous for their God, Muhammad. Let us be zealous for our God, Jesus Christ. Amen? We don't need a Muslim to show us how to be zealous for God. But sometimes I wonder if we don't. They kill for their God. We're trying to get to church. Amen? We're trying to just put on a smile when we don't feel like smiling. We're just trying to be nice to somebody. They're going the limit with their belief. Let us go the limit with our belief. If greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world, we should put all that to a shame for zealousness for God, for hot pursuit for the Lord. Amen? We sing a song and we think we've done so good. It's more than that. It's more than that. It's hot pursuit for God. It's a hot pursuit for the Lord. Where you speak about this one and that one, you need to love the Lord. You need to get with God. But if they only knew how you were after the Lord, your pursuit for the Lord, they would be totally amazed. Like, wow, you do? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Daniel prayed three times a day, not to mention the fasting that he went through. But look at what was on him. He knew all mysteries. God blessed him with that because he was a righteous man. He knew dreams. He could tell you why you're dreaming, what you're dreaming. He knew all dreams and visions, the meaning of them. Wow. That's our God. That's our Jesus. You want that? You want to be part of that? Pursue the one who loves you. Amen. He'll give you that. He'll give you that knowing. But we must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Pursue your God. You must believe. If you want to please God, you must believe the truth about God. You must understand God. We talked Wednesday night about that. It was a tough word. It really was. David was a man after God's own heart. King David was a man after God's own heart. But you know what happened in his life? He got his eyes on another woman. He had the wives he needed. He didn't need more. He had the women he needed. He didn't need more. And that was lawful for him. But what wasn't lawful for him? That he would take another man's wife. He called her to his place. And because being king, she just fell into his arms. He killed her husband to get him out of the way. And because of that, his whole house was in disarray. One of his sons raped his daughter. One of his sons tried to take over the kingdom. It was never right. Solomon, the blessed one, ended up worshiping demons. Oh my golly. Just because this man did not control himself and said, this woman is not my woman, that's... And it was one of his soldiers of his army, a good soldier. He came home on leave and he says, I won't even go in and sleep in my own home because my comrades that are out there on the battlefield are sleeping on the ground, and he wouldn't even go in the house and sleep. He slept on the ground outside. So dedicated man, and David killed him. Killed him. Took his wife. Later on, the baby that came forward died. And the Lord said to David, because you have done this, I forgive you, but the sword will never leave your house. The sword will never leave your house. Until David died, it was never like it was. And it could have been. We want to remember that about God. David says, I think about God and I tremble because he's such a mighty God and his judgments are righteous. He's holy. Everything God would do, he's holy. God forgive you, he's holy. God allows something in your life that would buffet you, he's holy. He's almighty. Talked about Paul's thorn in the flesh. That was, Paul, you didn't do anything wrong. This is going to keep you from doing wrong. You hurt me, God. God says I'm holy in what I do. This will keep you on your knees, this thorn in the flesh, this demon that I've allowed to be in your life. It'll keep you right. Paul says, but I don't like it. And God says, my grace is sufficient. Pursue me, Paul. Pursue me and it'll be okay. And the darkness will be held off at arm's length. Paul says, I don't like this. Listen, you got something in your life that this isn't quite right, and you're following God with all your heart. It's okay. I'm here to tell you it's okay. God will open a door. When he opens a door, you just please the Lord. You pursue him with all your heart. Amen? You pursue him with all your heart. Must believe that God is, and he's a rewarder, and he will reward you because he is holy. In James 4:7, it says, actually 4:6, but he gives more grace. Wherefore, he said, God resists the proud, but gives grace unto the humble. That's what we want. Amen? Amen? He gives grace to the humble. Submit yourself, therefore, to God. Resist the temptations of the devil, and he will flee from you. When the devil wants you to do something, and we were talking about there, you're always going to be tested. You're always going to be tested. God tries the reins in the heart. He always tests his people. And you'll have a test here and test there. And then you'll go for a period of time and everything will be okay. And then all at once a test come. And the test could be your anger, your viciousness, Could be that old man down inside and says, and you're just starting to lose it. And God says, I'm testing you. Are you going to follow me? Or are you going to put that away? Are you going to resist? Because the devil wants to destroy you. He wants to utterly destroy your life, where you can look back on your life and it's nothing but misery. And God says, why don't you come and follow me? And the sun will come up in it. Yes, the devil's going to come and tempt you, but you don't need to give in. Amen? Amen. Because we serve a mighty God. Hallelujah. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, he'll flee. Draw nigh to God, and he'll draw nigh to you. This isn't somebody that's far away from God. I don't care how holy you are. You can do better. Amen? Yes. You can get closer to God. I don't care if you think you got God in your shirt pocket, and you very well might be. How would you like him deep in your heart? Amen? Yes. It can always be better. Always be better. Always be closer. Always be more intimate with the Lord. So God says, draw nigh to me. Your loved one says, draw nigh to me, and that's God. You draw nigh to me, and I'll get closer to you. You draw closer to me, and I'll reward you abundantly. Sometimes we lose hope as Christians. Well, can't get any better. I'll just keep status quo. I say no to that. I say keep pushing in. Amen. Your places where you're not totally right, and in the night you say, God, forgive me, I was wrong. Deal with those areas, and God will bless you. Amen. Even more. Is there anyone here that doesn't need a blessing every day? Is there anyone here that doesn't need the grace of God upon you? The kindness of the Lord. Is there anyone here that doesn't need the favor of God? That when a situation could go right or left, that it goes your way. You can't get too close to God, because if you do, if you think you are and you're close enough, you have already fallen. You've already fallen. You're not close enough. When you think you're close enough, you're the Pharisee that stands in the temple and said, Lord, I thank you I am not like this other guy. Because the other guy says, Lord, I am not even worthy to look up to you. Forgive me of my sins. And the Pharisee says, I'm so glad I'm not like this publican. I'm so glad I'm not like him. I tithe everything that I have. And not only that, I fast twice a week. I don't eat anything. And maybe he wasn't even drinking any water. For I am righteous, and I thank you, God, that I am righteous. And God says, you are sinning just because you even said such a thing as that. You should thank me that you got the strength to fast and to pray to me. But are you pure before me? Only the blood of Jesus Christ will make you pure. God said this, that when the Pharisee left, he was unrighteous before God. But the other man, God accepted, and he left righteous. We cannot get too close to God. Amen? We cannot think, oh, I don't need to pray today. I don't need to pray right now. We just ask God for the Spirit to be able to pray through us and help us. That's why God gives us the Holy Spirit. James says, draw nigh to God, and he'll draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. You know what a double-minded is? Double-minded is thinking about God 1 hour, and the next hour thinking about dirt. Oh, baby, you know I love you. And then the next moment, there's hate going on. You know how that goes, you guys. I know the stories. I just happen to be the pastor. Amen? Oh, I guess you know it's like an open book. Well, I do, and I know. And I know what goes on, and I know what the devil wants to go on in our lives. Amen? And that's double-mindedness. When one wants to fight, the other one says, no, let's just not do this time. Come on, baby, I'm ready. No. No, we're not going to do that. We're going to stop it all. We're going to give it up. Yeah, but I'm really mad. You didn't make those fritters like you said you would. Be afflicted and mourn, weep, let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves, therefore, in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. He will lift you up. You do no good for yourself or anybody else to be downtrodden, amen? To be a spectacle to the community, it's no good, right? Amen. You must be lifted up. However, God wants to lift you up, but nevertheless, lift it up that you'd be a delight to God and to your community. Amen? That's what it's all about. Doing what you're called to do because we serve a mighty God. That God would establish his covenant with you. In Psalms 107, 45, and he remembereth them. He's talking about Israel, his covenant. And he repented according to the multitude of his mercies. We serve a God that is merciful. We have a covenant with God. We have a contract with the Lord since Jesus Christ is our Savior. And we've confessed him as that. And we live a life as that. We have a covenant with God. What's in the covenant of the Lord? The forgiveness of your sins. God has a covenant, and it is because of the multitude of his mercies that he enforces that covenant in our lives. How many times has God forgiven you? Think about it. How many times has God forgiven you of your wrong? Can you count them on your hands? Can you write that far? 1, 2, 3. Could you count that far? Could you remember? How many times has he forgiven you? Tell me today that he's not a merciful God, that he's put a peace in your heart, that you know you're forgiven, but you shouldn't be. You shouldn't be, because you're so wrong in areas of your life that you shouldn't be, but yet God says, I'm going to establish my covenant in you, and I'm going to forgive you. It says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord. 107. 1. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. If that's not good, I don't know what is. If he didn't help you with anything else in your life, but just forgave you of your sins, took you to heaven. If you found yourself just having to fend for yourself down here, but you made it to heaven because he enforced that part of his covenant and said, I'll just forgive you. Because I know you hate what you're doing and you keep asking for forgiveness, and God says, I'm going to be faithful to that and I'm going to forgive you. And I know it's real when you say, God, I want to change. But some things dog you until the day you take your last breath and you go, God, I don't know how you can forgive me, but forgive me. And God says, because of my mercy, I will establish my covenant with you. Now come to heaven instead of going to hell. Now if that isn't a good God, I don't know what is. Amen? Amen. That is worth clapping about. That is worth shouting hallelujah, because each one of us fall in that hole. Amen? Amen. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, as he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Devil wants you to go to hell and suffer with him. Didn't it say hell was made for the devil and all his angels? As far as I'm concerned, he can be there alone. He had everything. He walked with the Lord. Satan walked with God. He had it all. And he got pride in him because of what God gave him. God gave him looks, gave him glory. And he beheld himself one day, and pride entered him. God give you a pretty face. God give you this. God give you that. Don't get prideful about it. It was given to you by God. Amen. Amen. God give you a personality that just, you can walk in a crowd and just cause everybody, you just liven up the whole party. God gave you that. Be humble about it. Amen. And use it the right way. He's such a faithful God. In 1 Corinthians, I want to just lift up God today. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. There is no temptation, verse 13. There is no temptation that has taken you such as common to man. But I want you to see this. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able. But with the temptation, I want you to see here, sometimes God don't take the temptation away from you. Sometimes you want that weakness that's in your life taken away from you, and many times God does it, and you're an overcomer, more than a conqueror. But this is what God says. But with the temptation, he also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear what? The temptation. But with the temptation. Well, how many times do we say, oh God, take the temptation away. Take it away. And God says, how about this? How about if I just make you strong right now? How about if I just make you strong right now? And I don't take the temptation away. But when it comes to you, you're able to put it down every time. Isn't that better? Amen? Because all temptation will come in all different packages. But just give me strength, God, to be strong. Amen? That ye may be able to bear it. This is what Paul said. And this is our God. It's kind of like this. Give me a meal, give me a meal, give me a fish. And you give a guy a fish and he said, hey, give me that fish back. I'm going to give you a fishing pole. Let's go all to the lake. I'm going to show you how to fish. Amen? You give him one fish, you know the old story. He'll be hungry again in a little bit. Teach him to fish. You'll see him out there raking them in. Amen? Not only that, he might make a little bit of money selling the fish to the people who don't know how to fish. That's what God does. He says, why would I take the temptation away when I just make you strong and you can deal with all the other temptations? Isn't that better? Pursue the one that loves you, and that's what God says, and I'll make you strong. Amen? Draw close to me, and I'll draw close to you. That's just how the whole thing works. You're going to like this next verse, if I can get there. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 10, this is what Paul said. I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in other words, in sicknesses, in things that aren't going right. Now, you think this guy's crazy, right? But he's learned the art of being close to God and God being close to him. He knows that nothing can destroy him. Nothing can destroy him. He can get knocked down, but he will not be destroyed. He says, therefore, I take pleasures in infirmities and reproaches, in necessities, things that I need. He says, I take pleasure in that. In persecutions, a man was persecuted. In distresses, for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, God comes in and makes me strong. He was able to deal with it. He was able to deal with it when people didn't like him. He says, I take pleasure in it because God can put it in my heart where it doesn't matter. I just keep on trucking. Amen. Remember, God doesn't take all those temptations away from you. He just builds you up and makes you strong. And they're right there. If you're a doper, and we can be dopers from the doctor to the guy on the street. We can get it from the doctor. We know that. Some doctors just dish it out. And we know that we shouldn't. I don't care what the doctor says. We know that we shouldn't. And say, God, make me strong, that I don't give in to this. Amen? God says, and this was what Paul would say, I take pleasure in the temptation of itself. Because when I feel weak, I always go to God and I always come back out of my prayer room victorious. I am made strong because he establishes his covenant with me. That's what Paul said. In Galatians 6:7, it says, be not deceived, God is not mocked. For whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. Sow God into your life, and you'll get God in your life. Amen? Sow hell in your life, and you'll get hell in your life. Amen? Amen. Sow sin will come back and eat you up. Sow the Spirit of God, and the Spirit of God will come back and heal you up. Amen? Amen. For he that soweth to the flesh shall also of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit of God shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting in heaven and live forever and ever. Amen? Amen. That's good stuff. Love instead of hateful anger. Love, and you'll get love. Let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Goodness is coming. Keep sowing it. Keep loving your wife. Keep loving your husband. Keep loving, and it'll come back to you. Amen? Keep loving and putting up with people that seem to want to put you down. Keep loving them, and you'll win them over. Amen? With the love of Jesus Christ. It's all about Jesus. Amen?
We hope today's message has inspired you. We invite you to join us in person for one of our services on Sunday mornings or Wednesday nights at 715 West Lincoln Avenue in Pontiac, Illinois. You can also learn more about our church and hear more of Pastor Jim's messages by logging on to ChristianFellowshipOfPontiac.com.